Hey, this is Dr. K from iMedicalSchool. Have you ever wondered how someone can have heart failure with a normal ejection fraction? Well, stick around. I guarantee you'll learn something. If you do, make sure to like, share, subscribe. Heart failure is when the heart is not able to effectively pump blood into the systemic circulation, leading to symptoms like shortness of breath, swelling the legs, and even fatigue. Heart failure affects 6.2 million people in the United States, with 550,000 new cases diagnosed each year. Heart failure remains the most common diagnosis for hospitalized patients who are 65 years or older and leads to $30.7 billion in healthcare-associated costs per year. As a result, it's vital to understand what heart failure is to adequately treat it. Check out the link in the description of JAMA's review article about heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. Heart failure is broken down into two main categories: heart failure with reduced ejection fraction and heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. The ejection fraction, or EF, of the heart is the percentage of volume the heart pumps from the left ventricle to the systemic circulation. Heart failure with reduced ejection fraction is defined as having heart failure symptoms with an ejection fraction of 40% or less. Heart failure with mildly reduced ejection fraction is defined as heart failure with an EF of 41 to 49%, and heart failure with preserved ejection fraction is heart failure with an EF of 50% or greater. Surprisingly, 50% of heart failure patients have a preserved ejection fraction, and since 1987, the incidence of heart failure with a preserved EF has climbed by 16%. Given how many people are affected, let's talk about the five most important things to know about heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. Number one, the main risk factors for heart failure with preserved ejection fraction are older age, hypertension, diabetes, obesity, and coronary artery disease. Hypertension is the most common finding among those with heart failure with a preserved EF. In fact, studies have shown that when high blood pressure is treated, per the American College of Cardiology hypertension guidelines, there is a 40% reduction in heart failure with preserved EF over 8 years. The response to good blood pressure control highlights that uncontrolled hypertension is a key cause of heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. Promoting free blood pressure screenings for the public is a low-cost, key step to making people aware they have uncontrolled hypertension, and with treatment, help reduce the risk of heart failure in the future. Another major player in the development of heart failure with preserved EF are inflammatory conditions. We know that fibrosis, or scarring of the heart muscle, also called the myocardium, is more frequently seen in heart failure with preserved EF. It is believed that pro-inflammatory conditions like diabetes and obesity cause chronic myocardial inflammation and create an environment where heart cells demand more oxygen. The stress applied on heart cells leads to dysfunction in the healing process, which promotes continued chronic inflammation and eventual scarring. The idea of chronic inflammation contributing to heart failure with preserved EF still needs to be further investigated to help identify treatment targets. Number two, 30% of patients with heart failure with preserved ejection fraction have normal BNPs of less than 100. Most people with heart failure with preserved EF present with difficulty breathing and may have other heart failure symptoms like leg swelling, jugular venous distension, ascites or fluid in the belly, and the presence of abnormal heart sounds. Typically, when we think of heart failure, one of the most frequently used tests is a BNP or B-type natriuretic peptide. BNP is made in the muscle layer of the left ventricle of the heart. BNP is released by the heart cells when there is increased pressure and stretch of the left ventricle. When BNP is released, it promotes urination and vascular dilation, resulting in decreased pressure in the vascular system. Typically, we order a BNP as a marker of heart failure, but studies have shown that up to 30% of those with heart failure with preserved EF will have a normal BNP. What do you think would be another way to evaluate heart failure? Well, do not forget about trusting your physical exam skills. Of course, diagnostic imaging is important, but one of the key physical exam findings is jugular venous distension, or JVD. JVD is identified by laying a patient back at a 45-degree angle. We examine the patient from the right side, as the right internal jugular vein is most accurate in assessing heart pressure. The reason is that it is connected in a relatively straight line to the right brachiocephalic vein and superior vena cava. On the other hand, the left internal jugular vein connects to the left brachiocephalic vein, but has to cross over the chest to the right side. So mediastinal structures can push on this area and affect the interpretation of JVD on the left. You measure the height of the internal jugular vein from the sternal angle, which is where the second rib attaches to the sternum. Then typically add 5 centimeters to this value. Normal is a total value of 9 or less. Higher values may indicate heart failure. In addition, there are 2 important physical exam findings you should be aware of: Kussmaul sign and the abdominal jugular test. Kussmaul sign is when you observe JVD during inspiration. Normally, inspiration causes a negative pressure in the chest, allowing for increased heart filling and thus decreased JVD. In constrictive or restrictive cardiomyopathies, like with scarring of the myocardium, inspiration causes no decrease or even an increase in the JVD. The second physical exam finding is the abdominal jugular test. This is when you apply sustained pressure in the mid and right upper quadrant. The goal is to increase venous return. In response, normally you will see JVD be accentuated for 2 to 3 heart cycles, then return to normal. For those who have increased right-sided heart pressures, you will see the JVD remain elevated for 10 or more cycles with continued pressure. Understanding how to assess heart failure without relying on labs may be helpful in preventing you from missing a diagnosis. Number 3, the H2FPEF score is helpful in identifying heart failure with preserved ejection fraction in those who present with unexplained shortness of breath. Heart failure with preserved EF can be difficult to diagnose. A key tool to aid with the diagnosis is the H2FPEF scoring system. This system was developed at Mayo Clinic to estimate the probability symptoms are related to heart failure with preserved EF versus a non-cardiac cause. H2FPEF is an acronym that identifies the factors used in the scoring system. These factors are heavy BMI greater than 30, hypertension and treated with 2 or more antihypertensives, atrial fibrillation, pulmonary hypertension with a pulmonary artery systolic pressure greater than 35 millimeters of mercury, elder with age greater than 60 years old, and a ratio of peak velocity of early left ventricular filling over peak early diastolic velocity of the left myocardium next to the mitral annulus being greater than 9. This ratio is otherwise known as the E-E' ratio on echocardiogram. Adding up these factors, if you get a sum greater than 5, this indicates at least a 90 to 95% probability of heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. Now, we must understand H2FPEF is a scoring system, and it should be used as an aid to our clinical judgment. In addition, there are echocardiogram measurements that are needed for the system, and these measurements are subject to interpretation by the reading physician. So that can influence the utility of the scoring system. Either way, it's important to know that there is a tool available to help with identifying those with heart failure with preserved EF that may go undiagnosed. Number 4, diagnosing heart failure with preserved ejection fraction requires at least an echocardiogram, but may also require a right heart catheterization. Physical exam and lab work can provide clues that someone has heart failure with preserved EF, but how do we confirm the diagnosis? The first step when diagnosing any type of heart failure is to obtain an echocardiogram, assuming an EKG has already been completed. An echocardiogram is essential to calculate the H2FPEF score. In addition, to meet a criteria for heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, we first need an EF greater than or equal to 50. An echocardiogram will confirm if the EF is preserved. On an echocardiogram, we can measure the pulmonary artery systolic pressure, which is commonly elevated in heart failure with a preserved EF. An elevated pulmonary artery systolic pressure is not diagnostic of heart failure with a preserved EF, but if accompanied with shortness of breath, an older person, heart failure with preserved EF should be on your differential. In those where the diagnosis is still unclear, after a Doppler echocardiogram, then a right heart catheterization is needed to estimate left ventricular filling pressures. Left ventricle filling pressures are elevated in heart failure with preserved EF. First-line therapy for heart failure with preserved ejection fraction after treating risk factors are sodium glucose cotransporter 2 inhibitors. The first step in management of heart failure with preserved ejection fraction is to treat the main risk factors. As we discussed, hypertension remains a large risk factor for heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. Treatment of high blood pressure with antihypertensives is the first step. Two medications to consider are mineralocorticoid receptor antagonists, or MRAs, and angiotensin II receptor blockers, or ARBs. MRAs like spironolactone and ARBs like olmesartan can help decrease hospitalizations, particularly in those who have a lower end of normal EF. Another class of medications called SGLT2 inhibitors have been shown to decrease hospitalizations and reduce cardiovascular mortality in heart failure with preserved EF. SGLT2 is a pump in the proximal tubular region of the kidney nephron. The SGLT2 pump is responsible for reabsorbing 90% of the glucose that enters the urine. SGLT2 inhibitors help decrease blood glucose by allowing for excretion of glucose in the urine and preventing the glucose from being reabsorbed. The reason this is important is that as glucose reabsorption is limited with these medications and more glucose exits with the urine, water exits in large amounts as well due to osmotic diuresis. This leads to loss of excess fluid from the body, improving heart failure symptoms and vascular pressure. Also, the SGLT2 inhibitors typically do not cause hyperglycemia, as it only prevents reabsorption of glucose. As there's less glucose in the blood, there's less glucose in the urine. So the effects of these medications decrease as the glucose levels reach more normal ranges. Example of SGLT2 inhibitors include empagliflozin or Jardiance, canagliflozin or Invokana, and dapagliflozin or Farxiga. As we know, obesity plays a significant role in heart failure with preserved EF. A recent article released in the New England Journal of Medicine has recently shown that semaglutide, a diabetic drug also used for weight loss, helps improve heart failure symptoms and physical function while aiding weight loss in heart failure with preserved EF. Well, those are the five things to know about heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. If you learned something, help support the channel by giving us a like, share, and subscribe. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.